Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.
Good evening and welcome to Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks County. I'm your host, Amanda Machik, and tonight I'm joined by Elam Stoltzfus from the Nicholas Stoltzfus Homestead in Wyomissing. Thank you so much for joining me tonight, Elam. How are you?
I'm doing great. I love this weather, springtime special.
Yes. So we are, we're doing our show virtually again, but Elam has a really great presentation, a PowerPoint slideshow presentation that he is going to show during the program. And he's going to talk about one of the big upcoming events at the homestead, which is going to be their quilt benefit auction. And then you'll hear a little bit more about the site. And if we have time, a little bit of history of the Amish in Berks County. So, Elam, I will turn it over to you.
Okay. Thank you, Amanda. And yes. So I will start the slideshow here.
Yeah. All right. Perfect.
Okay. And I'm assuming the slideshow is there. Are we good to go?
I don't see it yet. So if you want to...
Okay. Let me see. I forgot one thing.
That's okay.
I didn't share it. That's what it was.
Yes.
Okay, hang on just a minute. Share screen. Where's that at? Here it is. Okay.
There we go. Yes. Excellent. All right. Fantastic. All right.
Now we're good to go.
Okay. Sorry great. About it's that. Nice to be too.
I'm Elam Stoltzfus, and my wife and I, Esther, we're the directors of the Nicholas Home. Nicholas Stoltzfus Homestead here in Wyomissing. And what we understand is this is one of the oldest houses in the Wyomissing borough. So one of our big deals every year, and this is year number 20, is our benefit auction that we have every year. We kind of have that theme, bring something, buy something. And so you can see on the slide, so the action starts at 9 a.m. There's going to be some breakfast served. We have a lot of great food, quilts at 11 a.m., books at 12, and we got a great collection of vintage and old books. So kind of to get the day started, they sell a lot of household items, garden supplies. We have quite a bit of nice furniture donated already. And so our family, many of them live in Lancaster, and donate different items that will be sold that day. So I'll kind of go through that. So this is just a quick example of what it looked like last year. And part of what happens here is many of the family come, and it's also like almost half reunion. But it's also really fun to see the local community, Berks County, come out and be a part of that, kind of learn about the Amish history in Berks County, but also support some of the items and causes we have here at the homestead. So books, a lot of old vintage books. We'll have 143 lots, some old German and English Bibles. We have some old books about German, Berks County and German history. So if you want to see the catalog, go to nicholasstoltzfus.com on the website, and you can download a detailed catalog of the 143 lots of books. Just kind of highlight a few. All our books have been donated to us. And one of the books that we're promoting is 1748 Martyr's Mirror, and it was printed at the Effort of Cloister. So there's not many of these around, and all the pages are intact. It's in very good shape, but you can see the cover needs some work. So come and take a look at that. Another book that we're promoting is 1819 Holy Bible in German, and it has some fractur in it that you can see where it belonged to Jonathan Lapp. Here again, these were donated from families that we can sell here. Now, we got about a dozen old German and English Bibles donated to us. And so this is one that has the records of You can see the Criders, Crofts, Shank, Bear, Landis, different records in this one here. And this one's in English. And the year is 1872. Here we have another one, 1887. Has the death records of a Bowman family, a Souter family, and that would be from the East Earl area. Then here's one that's really unique. This is an 1869. This Bible is in German and has the records of the John Wood family, and we find them in Indianapolis. And I tried to track them down, but I couldn't do that. So it even has some family portraits in. So if you want to see what people look like in the 1800s, kind of cool. Cool Bible. And here again, if you want to see the detailed list, this is just a sample of what it looks like and some of the books that we have. We have this year, for some reason, we had several people give us a large collection of handmade doilies. We just got some more today. That was so doilies, is that like knitting? Is that correct, Amanda? Knitting, crocheted? I don't know.
Crocheted, I think.
Crocheted. Well, they're handmade, and some of these are quite old. So they're vintage, but then we have some new ones too. We have this, one of our friends, she's 88 years old, and she still makes these, and they're so delicate. And we got quite a bit of glassware. And here again, I'm not an expert on this stuff, but that'll be on the auction. And here again, go to the Facebook page or on the website, and you get more information on this. These are some of the gifts that we're getting. I just got these last week. Yeah, Andy and Andy are going to show up. A lot of Amish made, like the wagons, we got some of those. We got a large collection of Falscroft dishes with the folk art in blue that will be auctioned off. And just a collection of quilts. We got two more quilts today. We'll have about a dozen different quilts. That's just a sample. And then you see we got two charcuterie boards, which are good size. I think about 18 inches by 10 inches, and it has the homestead engraved on it. You can see it says Nicholas Stoltzfus Homestead, 1771. The one in the bottom is a puzzle, and then there'll be a series of old barn frames with pictures in it of the homestead, and these are all photos that I had taken. One of the things that's going to be exciting this year, we had a family that donated us their great-great-grandfather's clothes from the mid-1800s. So what she's holding is an Amish suit from the 1800s, and they wore brown, not black like we see today. And so we'll have these on display, so an dress and another coat from the 1800s. So we're really excited about that. So we're having cabinets made because they're quite fragile. And of course, it's always about family and fun. Kids have a fun time coming here. That's just an example of what happened at one of the auctions. And different people connecting. These would be distant cousins on the Stoltzfus sitting down and talking to each other. It happens here at the homestead. And as well as community people, local people coming out and buying wares and different people interacting. And it's about having a good time. That's my wife, and she loves having people. So she's all smiles that day. Here at the auction, we get a very diverse group of people, local people, the Amish people, non-Amish, our cousins and distant cousins that are not Amish, they all come here. Lots of great food. We do a lot of barbecue, whoopie pies, and different things. And so here's an example of the quilts that we auction off that day. Like I said, we have about a dozen, so we don't do quite as many quilts as we used to. They don't bring quite as much. We're focused more on the books. Here again, everybody working together, family puts this on. One of the things we started doing, we have a computer system. It's called the Stoltzfus score. And so if you have Stoltzfus lineage, you can come and put your name in and you find out how you're connected back into Nicholas and Anna Stoltzfus. So that's always kind of fun. You can see with Berks County history was, it usually comes here. They won't be here this year, but we're having a Lenny Lenniapi Native American coming in and have some of his material here. We got several writers. One of the exciting things is we're going to have Charles Adam here. He wrote the highlights, the history of Reading, and he'll be here signing his books. So if you want an autographed copy, come on out and he'll sign it. He'll be here at Mastoff, so he'll be upstairs in the barn. The house is open, so we got all kinds of people that come through. One of our cousins, we call him Putsam, Sam Stoltzfus, and our son Nick. They'll be the tour guides. I'll show you around what it looks like. There's Nick, and he'll be one of our tour guides. So that kind of concludes that part of it. So, have any questions about the auction, Amanda, before I get into some of the history?
I don't think so. And for my, what was the time again? It's May 6th.
Yeah, it starts at 9 o'clock. And okay, you can come and get breakfast. You actually can come a little early if you want to. Breakfast, coffee will be here at 8. They do a little breakfast sandwich. But the auction starts at 9, and they'll start selling all kinds of art. We got artwork, doilies. We just got toys. It's going to be a pretty broad collection of different things. And then at 11, they sell the quilts. And then at 12, we start with the books. And the books usually go about an hour and a half. And then they finish the day out with whatever's left.
So do you have the schedule that you just read off to me? Is that on your website or anything like that? Or
it is. Nicholas.com. And the Facebook is Nicholas Stoltzfus Homestead. Is the Facebook.
Okay, great.
So either one, and we'll conclude with that slide. So kind of jumping backwards, so in 1730s, 40s is when many immigrants came into America, different Pietists, Quakers, Schwenkfelters, all those different groups. And so one of those groups was the Mennonites and the Amish coming from Germany. And so they scattered all across Pennsylvania, and then they settled here in Berks County. So the first organized Amish settlement was in Berks County. Many people think it was in Lancaster, but it was here, North Keel Creek, Chartlesville, and then down into Reading. So in its heyday, there were three different communities: North Keel, Irish Creek, and then Maiden Creek. This area here, which is really interesting, because like where the hospital is, where the park is, Lancaster Avenue. On 422, that whole corner, they were all Amish farms. Up here, where Penn State Berks was the backside of the Stoltzfus and the Zook farms. So here, this slide here. So in 1733, 36, all the way into the 40s, when a lot of families came here, but just wanted to highlight when the first ones came. And then the last Amish family that came to Berks County was Nicholas and his son Christian in 1766. And so soon after that, the Amish started leaving Berks County, gone out to Bedford County, Belleville, what's now Belleville, that area, and gone moving to Lancaster. By 1810, most of them had left Berks County. So who was the Stoltzfus family? So they came from Germany. Originally, they were from the Saxony area. And then they moved down to Zweibrücken, and that's where Nicholas was from. So kind of jump forward real quick. So we do know that they came to America in 1766, and they were on the ship Polly. And this is a painting, a rendering of it, of what it may have looked like, this typical three-mast trade ship. And we know they lived in Lancaster for a little while, and then they came up here and bought this tract of land in 1770 and 1771. And that's when they moved here. So here you can put a little map of the tracts of land. And so what was interesting here along the Klipphagen, all the farms were long and narrow because each farm wanted access to the water. So it made sense, you know. So he had almost 200 acres. So back up all the way where Sears Mall is, where the Berkshire Mall is, where the Dutch Farmers Market is, all that land, those places are at the backside of our farm. Like, just an interesting story up there where Home Depot is, would have been on our land. And I was up there a couple weeks ago, and I made mention, he was asking me, you know, what I do and where I'm at. And so I was talking about the homestead. I said, well, you know, Home Depot, it's on the backside of the original farm. He goes, oh, that's interesting. Then I kind of joked and I said, well, we want it back now. He said, well, I'll see what I can do about that.
So Home Depot on this map would be, it's where the shops at Y Missing are, basically.
Right, like, so you see Berkshire Mall there. So it would be about where the O and L is, right in there somewhere, is where Home Depot is at.
Oh, yeah, because there's Berkshire and Paper Mill. Yeah, okay.
Right, it's right on that corner. So yeah, if we could know what it looked like back then, it'd be pretty fascinating. But anyway, so one of the questions is what happened to the family? So we know Nicholas died in 1774. We don't know where he's buried, but we did find some records about 4 or 5 years ago. So when he died, he didn't have a will. So that triggered an estate inventory. And so because of that, we have a pretty good idea of what was in the house. And so their son, Christian, he became the Amish bishop. And then he moved to Lancaster and really helped the Amish churches there. So any Stoltzfus you ever meet came from here. There's only one Stoltzfus ever came to America. And Stoltzfus is not a well-known name in Germany either. So then their one daughter married John Schmucker. So many of the Schmuckers, Smokers, are also Stoltzfuses. And they live where the stone house is in Wyomissing Park. It's known as a stone house. We know it as a Schmucker house. Barbara and John, that was an Amish farm in that stretch right through there.
Yeah.
Up to where the hospital's at. So, yes. Yeah. And then their other daughter married Christian Four, which lived in Ole. So some of the Fours up there, we think, are distant kin. We're not sure. And then they had one of their other daughters. So when Nicholas died, she was 15. That's the last we hear of her. We have no idea what happened to her. She lost the history. So a little bit about the congregations of Reading. So on this map, you can kind of see where the different farms were at. So that's us up there, where 422, 12, and 222 come together. And then up there where Penn State Berks is at, where broadcasting comes out, that was an Amish farm. And then right across the Topahagen, where there are two farms, Jacob Lapp and a Schwarzenegger family, but as far as we know, there's no buildings there. But then you come down to the Schmucker house, the stone house that we were talking about, and then Christianzook and the Gerbers. That's right out there where Lancaster Avenue is, the corner where Lancaster Avenue comes on 422. And there's a graveyard there. If you remember, if you go 422, you see a graveyard, a little green building in there. That's the Gerber Fix Cemetery. So that was all the Kurtz and Gerber farm. They owned that whole corner all the way down to the Schuylkill River. And then you have the Keeneys, the Kurtzes, the Hertzlers. So it's kind of interesting. So places that we travel all the time were our ancestors. So here's a picture of the Daniel Zuck farm, which is on the corner of Broadcast and Topahagen. And that's the stone house there on the park, which would have been Barbara, Nicholas's daughter. Okay. So yeah, it's really interesting history. So here a few years ago, the Grings had owned the Nicholas Stoltzfus homestead, and they came to visit us, and they gave us this picture. The best we can tell, we think it was like 1917. And that's the original barn. And you can still see a little bit of the tow path there. What was left. But if you look close in front of the barn, you see a Gruber wagon, a threshing machine, threshing there. And of course, that's the house and the barn's gone. But that was you see the shocks, and you can see the old Lutheran church up there, the Kissinger Lutheran church building up there. And kind of a long story, but the Toons and Janssens bought the Nicholas Stoltzfus house or farm, the whole farm in about 1920 or 1930, maybe 30s. And then they farmed it, but then they were selling the lands off for development. And when they did this about late 80s, nobody lived here anymore. So by the year 2000, this is what the house looked like. And then the Stoltzfus family got a hold of it. Governor George Leader had owned it in the early 2000s. He worked out an agreement with the family, and they came and started to restore in the house. So it went from 1998 to 2003, and the inside was also in very, very bad shape, and the family came in, and most of it's done now. So here's a before and after. This is what it looks like right now, and the left is what we started with. So we're trying to make it look like the 1700s as much as possible. So we got three rooms that we really are pretty happy with. So it's the bedroom, has the old post and beam type bed. And from the inventory information, that's what was in here, a post and beam bed. So, and then here are two rooms in the house that we're trying to raise money to finish that have not been completed. And if we get these two rooms done, then the house will be completely restored on the inside. So that's what it looks like from the outside now. This is just a couple of years ago. This was last summer. One of the gifts my wife has is she loves growing flowers. And so she's out planting right now. Really it's come a long way. And then we live in the bottom of the barn. The bottom part is an apartment. And then upstairs in the barn is for activities and events. And then we open up an Airbnb on the one side. And we'll talk about that in a bit.
Elam, you had mentioned the barn when you were showing that other photo, that the barn was no longer there. So this barn is new?
Yeah, it's a replica. This was built in 2011. And it's almost in the same place. And it looks almost like the other barn. And they did not see that picture when they built this barn.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. So, but it looks really, and it's aging well, so it looks like it's old already. But,
my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So wintertime is magic. So there's another room of the one upstairs. And this is now the downstairs, the what we would call the dining room, or the back then they called it the stoop. And so we've got pretty good furniture. It's mostly 1700s, maybe early 1800s, but we're going for the 1700 look. But the one on the right, we were getting ready to do a fundraising. So we do a few suppers in here a couple times a year. So if anybody's interested in having a special event, we'll do that. That was October. We did a 5-course Pennsylvania Dutch meal for 12 people. We did 6 Friday night and then 6 people Saturday night. A lot of fun. We got school groups in here, and we have activities for them to do, like the schnitzel bunk and cross saw and different activities, colonial lifestyle. We want to get into making butter, but we haven't mastered that yet ourselves. So. And then the Airbnb that we opened up, which is on the top side of the barn, so you kind of see what it looks like. It's tiny. It's just one bed. But we've got a little dining room, full kitchen, full walk-in shower. And it's stayed busy. It's done quite well. And then the barn, we do weddings, special events, church events, reunions, different things like that. We got a busy summer lined up. We got 2 weddings coming up. So if you're interested, let us know. And then a lot of our own family, the families come home for a reunion. So this is last summer, a Stoltzfus family from Parksburg came up to spend the whole day here. And they love playing these croquet games. Here again, it's about people, connecting people, families coming and spending the day here. And so here's our mission, is to tell the Stoltzfus story, a place where memories are made, a place to bring families together, a place to relax and relive history. You can just look at these few photos. We did a few music events here. We had a band here for a wedding, like a jazz band. And so again, kind of circling back, the annual benefit, that's our big deal. So that's what we're promoting, and we're hoping we have a nice day. So come on out and share with us and be part of the Stoltzfus history. So if you want more information, the website, NicholasStoltzfus.com or .org, and our Facebook is Nicholas Stoltzfus Homestead, or you can email me at NicholasStoltzfusHomestead@gmail.com, and there's our phone number, 484-878-2916.
Now, do you have regular hours of operation at all, or is it all just kind of by appointment?
Yeah, we do not. At this point, so either come by or call us, send us an email. We do tours of the house, and we kind of design it for whatever you want. So it's like, I guess I got 2 different kinds of tours. If it's family, we talk a lot about genealogy, and if they're interested in the house or the grounds, we'll do that.
Okay.
And also, if anybody wants to come, just spend a day here, enjoy the grounds. We have a lot of yard games, bocce ball, tetherball. I think we got volleyball, we got basketball here, or bring your own games. And we just made an area now. We have a fire pit and some picnic tables around the area. We're going to put some lights up there, some Edison lights. We'll put that up here shortly. So yes, just come in and enjoy it. It's here for everybody.
Wow. And then is there a designated parking lot, or do you just kind of park along the street going back?
That's gated. But if we know you're coming, you can park there. But we have a partnership with the Berks County Parks right across from us. There's a parking area, and you can park in there. So like for special events, if you have a dozen cars, they can park there.
Gotcha. And that's like that's the trailhead for the towpath trail then, right?
It's one of them. Yeah,
there's one of them.
Several
of them.
Okay, that's one perfect spot.
Okay,
yeah, people come to fish there and do that.
Okay. Because you guys, you're like at the dead end, right?
We are. Yeah, there's no through road.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. Very cool. Yeah. And besides the event coming up on May 6th, do you have other public events, or are they more just like the rentals and like the reunions and things like that?
That's all we have now, but we are talking about doing something in the fall. We haven't quite figured out how to do that.
Okay.
One of the things we've been talking about is some of our family said they would come up and they would help put on an Amish wedding meal. That was one thing we talked about. The other thing, I wanted to create a partnership with some of the farmers, and I talked to the barn organization at one time, but they changed a lot of different people now. And so, but to have like a fall harvest festival where we set tables up and different vendors could bring food in, almost like a one day farmer's market, but local.
Yeah.
So we're open to something like that. We just haven't gone there yet, because I spent a lot of my time the last 2 years. First of all, we had to rezone the place, and that took quite a while. And then last year we restructured our board. And so now this year it's trying to finish the house out. We did a lot of work on the barn.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, just call us and let us know, or stop by, and there's somebody here most of the time because we live here, and we're volunteers here, so this is what we do.
Oh, well, that's wonderful. This is really interesting. I enjoyed the history too. It's always neat to see. I think when you've been on before, you've had similar maps with the different families and things on it. So that's always cool to see, the original plots. Going back, they're long and skinny, but that makes sense.
Yeah.
Makes sense. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much, Elam. It was great to have you on the show again. And we thank our viewers for tuning in this month. And we hope to see you next month for the show then. Thank you so much and good night.
Okay.
Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.